Does this noise read well? is it good?
That's the intro music.
Yeah. Just, then you just mix it a little bit.
Don't tempt me.
I mean, do it. I am purposely
tempted. It's a challenge.
Hey, students, welcome to episode 50, yes, 50 of the Film Student Podcast. I'm your host, Tony Lazzeroni. My guest this week is Murphy Dillow from the Magenta Cohort, but she didn't come alone. Past guest and Magenta classmate Graham Anderson joined her.
What do you call yourself?
Oh, me? I go for Swoosh.
Oops, sorry, Swoosh Anderson. We talk about what it was like for her to go through HRFS after film school, what it's like to work on a Hallmark movie set, something I know that my mom and sisters will love, and her hot take on the reboot of Murphy Brown. On with the show.
Oh, I was out of film school and I was doing nothing else.
Yeah.
And I was like,
what,
maybe.
What film school?
Western Carolina University Film School. And television production.
Are you from out that way?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah. You know, I went, because I lived in Charlotte through high school. Wow. So
I was like the middle of the state.
Yeah.
Not.
Yeah,
area.
Western Carolina that's not in Western Carolina.
Yeah, just from the Carolina region.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, that's, yeah, my sister went there, and so I was like, okay, I'll transfer there.
Yeah.
And then I went there, went to film school, and learned so many things, and by that I mean some things, not a lot. And then I was doing nothing for like 4 years.
How was that program? Like,
It was different than this one,
yeah.
For sure. This one is much more a storytelling school. That mm-hmm. one was like, we're going to teach you everything, and yet nothing you actually really need to know, like important things about like making it in your life, which is what this school does, so that's
yeah.
good. So it was good and bad.
Yeah. But so you, what got you from, is it just you were done with that one, you're like, I need more school? Or
I was like, I'm so bored. No, I was out of school and I was trying to do things and then I didn't do anything. And I was like, wow, I'm really bummed out about this whole thing. Because that's, of course, no one gets a job right out of film school or anything. So I was like, what do I do? I was like, I feel like I should learn more things. And then
yeah.
I was like, I also really want to get into comedy. And then it was like, a school for that mm-hmm. with films.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, well, what do you know? I'll do that thing. Yeah.
Why comedy? What was...
I have no idea. It's mostly just... comedy is a tool. It's mm-hmm. like a defense mechanism, and it's also just like a coping skill. So it's like... I was like, I enjoy it, and I've never done anything with it, and I would like to. So I was like, okay.
What kind of stuff were you producing when you were in school there? Like... Did
it
you actually get to make your own, like, was there, no, like, a final thesis film or anything
no,
like that?
No, everyone else didn't, like, and not everyone got to. Like, it was, like, they picked two students, and then everyone helped on, like, theirs. And so I was a producer on a a very funny film about depression. And
nice.
You got Graham and Maya's attention.
I know. Yeah.
Depression.
His final film was about depression.
Sounds
mine
delicious.
Was about suicide.
Yeah. It was pretty close. That's actually pretty much what that film was about. But
yeah.
No. So, and I didn't like producing because it meant I had to talk to everybody. And
yeah.
I was like, cool. I'm glad I got to get some experience in some different areas. And so this is that. I think it's some schools do like everyone does one, but mine didn't for some reason.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yeah.
So.
So I don't know. I forgot what the rest of your question was, but I'm sorry.
So what was how you got to here? So you saw this program. How'd you find out about it?
I was living in Atlanta, and then I would spend like a lot of time like trying to figure out like what I could do. Like I was thinking about going to grad school or doing mm-hmm. something to like. And I was like, I would like to do comedy, but if I can't, I can just do production design or something like that. That'd be fine.
Have you always wanted to do film and television, or
when I was like 12, I'd made a change of heart. I had a change of heart, yes. I originally wanted to be the next Ruth Bader Ginsburg.
Okay.
And then I was very much into political science. And then I
can see you as an RBG.
Yeah. And then I turned 12. And then for some reason, I got into the arts like an idiot. And here I am meandering through life with a fine arts degree. Oh, God.
Was there a spark for that? Or
there was like... When I was a kid, yeah, I think probably, but I was also severely ADHD, so that's the fault there. But I don't know. I just joined drama things and like band and art things. And I was like, I like this and it's fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I was stupidly was like, maybe a career could come from that?
Yeah.
Question mark.
I think that's what all of us at some point. It's like, it's like, this is sort of dumb, but I want to do this.
Yeah.
But so what kind of stuff, since you mentioned comedy, what kind of stuff is like your influences for the stuff that you create? Because you have a very, at least from your final film, you have a down to earth style, I think. And so I'm curious what your influence is. What are you pulling in to create that stuff?
I don't know. I do a lot of old things. Like most of my early influences were actually, ironically, Harold Ramis stuff was like from my dad, and like just everything from like, not a lot of modern things have been particularly influential except for like Saturday Night Live through the whole thing, obviously, which everyone from the school will tell you. But, like I watched that since I was a kid, even when I probably shouldn't have. And like I've watched like all kinds of very inappropriate stand-up when I was a kid. And I just like everything, like, I don't know. I'd say like 70s and 80s, like Bill Murray and that sort of thing. And then like anybody who was in Saturday Night Live that made a movie.
Yeah.
That was pretty much what I was watching.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what? Maybe I couldn't. Then I saw a lot of Robin Williams stuff too, and he was always influential on me. And I was like, okay, like.
You strike me as somebody that would be a Mrs. Doubtfire fan. Are you?
Okay. I do love Mrs. Doubtfire. It's not my favorite, but I do love it because he's just very goofy in that one. So
yeah.
I enjoy it.
What's your favorite?
My favorite is Patch Adams because it makes me cry.
Yeah. All right, so some emotional range, which I guess.
Yeah, but maybe you should work on that. Just hone it in for the comedy, for God's sake. Come on. No.
Well, and you had, for your final film, what was the title?
It was But Once a Year.
But Once a Year. It's one of my favorite scripts for this year. And it's about three sisters that are all coming home for the holidays, and their mom is very particular, I guess is a good way of putting it. And they all kind of screw up the holidays in their own wonderful ways, and she comes home and finds the place just in a wreck. And flips out.
Yeah.
Is that an accurate take on it?
Yeah, that's actually fun times I had by all in that.
But no, I thought it looks great. I'm looking forward to seeing a true final cut of it at some point in time.
I appreciate that. Thank you.
Otherwise known as keep working on it.
What do you mean?
Keep you finish the audio. That'll be it'll make a difference.
It will.
Because it looks good.
Oh, thanks. That's Diego and my mystery lighting person.
Yeah, who did the lights on that? Must be a wonderful person.
Yeah. Mm. I don't know.
Yeah, who did the lights on that?
I don't know. I didn't get to see the credits. My eyes were closed because I thought it was too scary.
What was scary about it?
Definitely just the whole holiday vibe. Just started freaking me out.
Not into the holidays.
No.
We're learning things today. Grandma's not into holidays. So what's the long-term hope for you? What do you want to do out of this?
Well, I'll probably get into some production design first, just because that seems like the easiest avenue for job things. And also, it's fun, so I mean, why not? And then someday, I'll write something or some sketches or something, and someone I know will know what to do with that, because I don't. Or I'll figure it out, maybe. Who knows?
Do you consider yourself primarily a writer?
I would say over a performance, yes, for sure. But I'm working on both. I would like to do both, but I'm not a person who was born as a performing person. So
yeah.
Yeah, I don't have a voice for comedy. I need like a Mike Kolar voice or perhaps a Graham Anderson voice to be.
I think you have a good voice for comedy.
It's ridiculous enough that maybe.
I'm hesitant to ever say somebody doesn't have a voice for comedy because some of the weirdest voices are some of the funniest ones. There was this one guy, I think it was Jimmy Dore or something like that, that I saw a Comedy Central special. He was like a Canadian stand-up, and he had this whole bit where he sounded nervous to say everything that he said, and he would always end up with an upward inflection, and then he'd chew on his teeth.
Can't imagine what that would be like. That must be.
But it was always like, it was somebody who was very... Like, he would mess with people, but he was always nervous talking about it. try and find it, like, the half-hour garbage. But, like, ever since I've seen that, I'm like, oh, you can really make anything work if you just find how to play with that voice
just
in the right
lean
way.
Into it in a
yeah.
way.
Lean into it. And I'm, you know, he has to be putting on some percentage of an act for that, but it had to start from somewhere. Like either he saw somebody else that was acting like that and he decided to lift it and try it for himself, or, you know, that was a voice that he actually had at one point in time and he's just blown it up. Like Jim Gaffigan with the sister-in-law's voice or something like
it
that.
Maybe he also does like a conscious thing,
like an audience voice. Yeah
the
it's
audience
like
that, but
voice.
That's it came from his like sister. He talked about it, that it's like his sister commenting on his stuff as yeah. he's going, which is why it's just a higher pitch version of his own voice. is he just jumps over and he's like commenting on it how she would say. No, it's but. Somehow that worked its way into the bit.
Caliente
so.
Pocket. That's my favorite. Caliente one. Pocket. Oh,
but yeah, like you can find some way of using that voice. We just need to get you into stand up.
Oh my god, it would just be the angriest stand up. It'd be like this really small person and being like, and just like immediately.
I can see that.
That's
working.
My only angle I've ever thought about. I was like, if I do stand up, it's got to be like really, it's got to be like Lewis Black. Like I'm just upset about everything because that's the only time I'm ever like fine with being like in front of people.
Be great if you're just like I love the idea of just walking up to the microphone. Everybody, Murphy Dillow.
All right, welcome. Like I'm just mad. Like, all right, geniuses.
Just sit there for a minute with that. But okay, so you would like to get to performer writer territory with this. What's the next step? Where you go from here?
I mean, I'd like to continue doing things with Second City. I'm not ready to leave this mm-hmm. place yet, so I'm hoping I can either take more classes or like put a show up. I don't know, something that mm-hmm. would be cool.
And you did so the production design stuff that you did. You worked on a bunch of films for production design, right? Like who else did you end up doing?
Oh god, I know I did Jeff's film Jackie. Like it was the first one I did.
Okay.
Jackie Gately, and then
Jackie Gately was the classroom
the
one.
Green cohort, and then yeah. I helped on Bridie Hicks.
Okay.
One.
Which is one of the most gorgeous films I think to come out of this program.
It was just
like,
so like string lit and like. Mm-hmm. Soft and fancy. No, oh my god, I've done so. I feel bad. They're gonna be like mad if they hear this and I don't like mention everything. I'll be like, yes, no. And that's
you're having the same complication that Dale did. Dale came out and I was like, so what film stand out? He's like, if I don't say every single student, like they're gonna freak out. Like everybody else is gonna be like, Dale, you didn't mention me.
No. Dale for sure was talking about me.
I mean,
I know.
It's like, where else are you gonna go besides?
Griffin? But he didn't say your name.
Yeah,
so.
But I could tell. I could just tell.
You know.
But yeah. So you, what else? You said to Jeff.
Yeah.
His term three.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. It's mostly at people's terms three, and then like Magenta's some of Magenta projects. I did Graham's, and then I did Robbie's as well.
Yeah.
So I helped as much as I could, I guess. So even if I wasn't production designer, I tried to be like useful in some capacity. Mm-hmm.
And production design here is bigger than it is on other sets because you end up it's like set design, costumes.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
it's almost art direction, but we're not giving art director credits because we're dumb like that.
No, comedy is very specific in a production design way because you have to especially sketch, like there's things mm-hmm. you always need something very specific for it.
Yeah.
Or like it's like you have to make something extra goofy. So like in a way you do get to exercise some sort of like humorous creative.
Right.
You know.
Oh, one of my favorite stories. I think I mentioned it before. It was on Super Troopers. Did I tell you about this one?
No.
On Super Troopers they have the scene where the couple shows up and they're both dressed as bikers, so they're incognito, and they have that whole gag of like, oh, biker, I'm an idiot, because he's dressed as like a cyclist and she's dressed as a biker chick. And that was because the costume designer didn't know which one based on the script they wanted, so they brought both
yes.
as options. And when they got there, they're like, that's hysterical. We're putting that in the movie. So it was just like an art director's interpretation that turned into one of my favorite jokes in that entire movie. Because it's so throwaway of, oh, biker, I'm an idiot. That's the only time they address it, and they just move on with the plot. It's so fucking great.
directors love options. I'm just saying they do. Works out.
So how do you break down a do you usually break down a script, or do you wait for somebody to deliver you like a list of what they're aimed at?
I mean, it just depends when I come into the process. Like if it's really late, like I just let them tell me what, but like if I have time with the script, then I'll just like I go through it, and I actually like I have a really severe like organizational thing in my brain, so I actually love doing that, like going through and like circling like this prop and when you need it here and making like lists.
Do you do the full breakdown with like the multicolors on the sheet?
If I have the time and it makes me feel like centered, I'm like, yes, I will do that. But if I don't have the time, then no, I would just be like, okay, what do we need?
Like I've watched those script breakdown videos online and see the guys that have like the set of like different markers. Color Sharpie cards. Markers that they can go through one by one and do it. And it's painful. So watch them go through and break that stuff down.
You just keep having to pick up pens and you're just like, oh my God. That's the start of my act. It's just God, like you just frustration.
we're gonna hammer through your first 5 minutes during this.
Oh good. Okay. That's great. That's actually why I'm here.
What's your first bit after after the deep breath?
It's just me being I've already told Graham about this. It's just like the first like 5 minutes is just me wearing a bag over my head. Because I can't want people to look at me. And then, like, the rest of it is just me, like, trying to talk, but then no one can hear me. So they're just screaming, like, louder at me. And, like, it's, like, one guy in the front row, the only person there, and he still can't hear me. That's pretty much what I picture. So.
So you're basically doing your own Andy...
Circus.
No, not Andy Circus.
Andy Warhol.
No.
Andy Kaufman.
Kaufman, thank you. I blanked on that. I think that's the name I've blanked on the most in this podcast.
I was going to guess Jim Carrey.
Because I've done it at least a half dozen times. Like, Andy Kaufman's come up, and I always blank on his name. And I, this is how terrible I am with names. Yeah. That would be my opening bit, would be how terrible I am with names. So I forgot a girl's name while I was dating her.
Oh my God.
What?
So just remember that, ladies.
That's
Tony crazy. Out here.
It has happened. No, I forget like family members' names, and like my brain is just not functional for names for whatever reason. And it's not functional for names of people that I know.
But like, if like my friend knows them,
if it's like a famous person or somebody that I've just heard about, I'm usually fine with that. Like Andy Kaufman being
the exception,
one of the exceptions. But like generally, like. For whatever reason, I can remember like famous people, but I can't remember like my friends.
That's very interesting. Should we explore that or what's that say about Tony?
Nothing important.
Let's dig deeper, Tony. I feel like there's some things we haven't addressed, you know. I'm talking about you.
I think we should
go into it.
But I'm talking about you because you're the guest on this episode.
Oh, see, I was hoping you weren't going to remember that. Okay.
I remembered. Just because I talked to Graham for a second doesn't mean that I forgot.
I really wish you would talk to Graham. Graham has a lot of interesting things to say.
Not at this moment.
Oh, my God. I hate you so much.
You're on your own.
I can't. Oh, my God. So much for friendship. That's fine. Jeez.
So what what are you working on right now? What are your projects that you're anything that you're still producing? Cuz what'd you do for your final written?
Oh, I did a pilot, but I think I mostly finished it, but like I mean I'd like if I write anything else I want to write like I have just a bunch of like small like sketch ideas and then maybe like another pilot, but
what was the pilot premise?
Which one?
The one that you finished.
Oh, that was the the sad family story, which is also happens to be the Murphy Dillow story somehow. That's all I write. And it's like a guy finds out when, like, after his dad, passes away, that his real father was actually, like, another person. And he owns a funeral home. And so he goes to the funeral home to, like, find him and, like, try to, like, win his acceptance and all this stuff. And it's just a lot of dead people and a lot of family drama. So it's a good time. It's a good time. Not anything like the show 6 Feet Under. No one's ever seen that. I don't know who keeps bringing it up. But
it's just because it's the only show that somebody. I'll give you another one. Bob's Burgers. Because they've got Mort next door. Like
Mort's actually my favorite. I love him.
Like that's not. Is that how is that the Murphy Dillow story? Is it just?
I just seem to write the same thing every. Thing like everything I wrote this year was like a sad family, or not sad, but just like some sort of ridiculous family thing, and there was always like a nervous character, and I was like, I need to branch out.
You say that, but like Steven Spielberg made a career out of making movies about daddy issues. Like,
you found your voice.
No, yeah. Good. Thank
it's
God.
Very specific.
What was the other pilot you were talking about?
Oh, that one. I have no idea what that's even about yet. But I was just like, I just wanted to write something about really sad, like, beach hotels off season, because I spent a lot of some time in like 2 months in like Myrtle Beach in like September through November, and it was like the saddest and yet most hilarious thing I've ever seen.
Why were you there?
I was there. That was actually when I was working on movies. I had like worked on 3 movies like back to back, and then they were all shooting in like South Carolina.
Yeah.
Like, and so we stayed in like North Myrtle Beach, which is hysterical because it's not even Myrtle Beach; it's just
North Myrtle Beach. Yeah, it's a fake one. It's,
yeah.
They do that around that part of the country because when I went to work, I worked for a company called Blackbaud that was in Charleston, and they have North Charleston.
Oh, of course they do.
North Charleston is not Charleston. If you ask anybody in Charleston, they're like, "Yeah, they're just liars." That entire city is full of liars.
I was like, North Myrtle Beach, the only thing it says on the sign is home of Vanna White. So I'm pretty sure.
That's pretty cool.
I'm pretty sure that town is crushing it.
Yeah.
Whoever's listening, I hope I'm going to send this to people I know in Myrtle Beach. And
in Myrtle Beach.
Make sure.
Not North Myrtle Beach.
No.
You don't know people in North Myrtle Beach.
Like I would ever keep in contact with people from North Myrtle Beach. Unbelievable. God.
We just killed 75% of our audience right there.
Yeah. Oh, God,
we were
no.
huge in North Myrtle Beach until this episode. And now we'll get like the 3 people in Hollywood
well,
to download this.
That'll enjoy your last episode, Tony. This is the one. This is the one right now.
Murphy, shut it down. Sorry, with their blistering, the blistering opinions yeah. of North Myrtle Beach.
That's what's going to bring everything down. I
it's
think.
A weird part of the country. I've been to Myrtle Beach a couple times. My buddy got married just north of there.
North of North? That's interesting.
North of North is it's actually in North Carolina. It's just over the border. It's Beaufort?
Oh, something like good times. Yeah,
yeah.
Beaufort.
Yeah, and but it's. An interesting area because it's very much a tourist trap from the
80s. It's a mess.
And yeah. So it's kind of stuck in the 80s. Like,
like a Twilight Zone episode.
Right? Yeah, it was just like, God, it was like everything was like, had like a beach name for no reason.
Yes.
And like, it was like even pancake
just
houses.
You
and
forgot.
You were like, yeah.
Just in case you forgot, you were at the beach.
Yeah. And it was like, if you're here like any other time of the year, this is just really sad. Like, and I find that hysterical.
How confusing is it for locals? Like, you want to go to that beach place? Which one?
Let's go to that good seafood place we know. Like, which, like, we don't know. That was everything. It's just, like, a bunch of brightly colored houses and, like, run-down places. And
yeah.
It's just great.
And places that have been destroyed by a hurricane at some point in time and sort of rebuilt, but not entirely.
Yeah, they weren't trying really hard. Like, yeah, it was, like, a little bit. Yeah. That's pretty much most of South Carolina. Oh, sorry again to your audience in South Carolina.
My massive listening
yeah,
audience.
Yeah, I know.
In South Carolina. I will get maybe one Twitter message.
Yeah. Well, I'm from North Carolina, so I'm supposed to be a complete butt to your entire state.
Because so. we're the North Carolina to Carolina. Like
yeah,
that's like. I still love, I'll pick on Robbie about this, but Virginia and West Virginia.
Yeah, whatever that's about.
Slightly west.
It's not, it was all a part of the same Virginia, and the West Virginia is like, no, we're our own thing.
We can do it by ourselves.
What do you
want to
name it? The same thing. You can't do that. Slightly different thing.
So much more west than you. Oh, God. Yeah, it's
but
like,
they're not.
That's
they're
exactly
not even.
The point.
It's not even that far. But yeah, so tangents are fun.
Aren't
so,
they? God. Yeah.
So you worked in productions. What were the movies that you were working on?
I'm not going to bring up any names because then if anyone sees them, I'll have to leave
Isn't
Chicago.
Isn't there one on Netflix?
There is not. How dare you?
Is there?
There is not. The point is, they're all very, they were all by the same like company and they sold some of them to like Lifetime and like Hallmark Channel. So it's that sort of situation.
Awesome.
And so it's like you make like it's like you meet a lot of cool people, but also a lot of crazy people.
Did you work at all on Kim Pinto's final film?
I did not, but I saw it and I was like, yes.
Is that like how it feels for those sets? The idea of Hallmark movies is fascinating to me because my family, that's like the one thing that we can watch during the holidays that like doesn't bring up some politics or something like that. Like it's very benign. Everybody can watch it, you know. But I'm the production process on those fascinates me because it's got to be somewhere between like TV and a movie.
Oh my God, it's like really fast, and then like it's like if you spend like we spent 2 months together because we were making three movies, but like it's literally like you work like 72-hour weeks, and you have like you work 6 days, and you have a break, and then you go back, and it's like a 2 weeks maybe for like per movie, and it's like ridiculous.
2 weeks for like a what, like a 60 minute or
yeah, it's like maybe like an hour and a half at most. Like it's like not that much.
So you're talking, we'll say, a 90-page script, and you're doing it in 10 days. So that's effectively like 10 pages a day, like 9-10 pages
like,
a day.
Yeah, it's pretty fast. Like you don't realize how like tired you are, and then you get to like day six, and you're like, where am I? Like what's going on? Like you don't even. But
do
yeah.
they run like multicam or anything like that, or is it still single cam?
I think maybe sometimes, but like on most of the ones I was on, like they had like a single cam, and they had like very little like special equipment stuff. Like they had like one guy had like a big like jib arm thing that he like made because his company like makes that. But that was like, and that took like all day to set up. And it was like we had like a rain thing at one point, and that was like the most stressful days on set that I've ever had. And otherwise it's just like very simple, like, okay, we're gonna dolly in this one time, but like no more.
Yeah.
It's just
I watched a video the other day. It was an ad of some sort for like Kessler Crane or, you know, one of the crane companies, and they shot it so that all you see is you see the person dropping all the pieces into place for building this crane. Like you don't see him go and get it out of the box and like unpack everything and then bring it over and attach it and screw all the things in. Like you just see it like slot in, like they cut it together that way. And it's still like 25 pieces to put this thing together. And it's like a 5-minute video. And I'm like, so you compress that down. That was probably like a 2-hour process to just assemble that damn thing. And there's like weights that they're showing, like just slipping them in to counterbalance the camera and then mounting up the camera. Oh my God.
It's that easy.
I would shoot myself.
He stops in the middle just to have a snack. He's like, I'm just God.
So have you seen the final product of these films that you worked on?
I watched, I think maybe like two of them. I think you can see me in one of them. So I didn't want to watch it, but I was like, okay. So I was like,
want to see that one.
No, you really don't.
I do.
It's like one of those things where like it's a good movies to work on, but it's also like sometimes like plot things are like the issue you have with them. But like it is fun to like work on them and like get the experience and like.
What you mean, a Hallmark movie has a plot hole?
No way. Not in my experience.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I feel like I know it's an unpopular opinion, but like I'm just saying, like to me it felt that way. So you know.
So how many of those did you end up? You said there were three,
three
at a time. Oh, yeah. So just three. So you've seen two out of three movies that you worked on.
I've seen bits of the other one, but yes.
Enough to know that you might be in it and you don't want to see it.
Yeah, yeah. I was like, yeah, okay.
What, like, how did you get into that? Was it stuff just from the school that it was regional, or did you actually get hired by the production company?
I'm trying to think. Somehow a friend of mine from Western, like, knew somebody who was, like, working on them and, like, or, like, was working with them, and so, like, he worked for an equipment rental place, so they were like talking to them about that, and then he was like, they're looking for someone in art department, and he was like, well, I do know somebody.
Gotcha.
And then he was like, okay, and then they got in touch with me, and then they just kind of talked to me, and then they were like, do you want to be on this thing? And I was like, yeah, sure. Like I'm that'd be cool. Like this is an actual movie.
Yeah.
Out of school, I would love to do that.
Yeah.
So.
Is this why you're in Atlanta? Is that from the home?
Atlanta was, I just moved, I went back to North Carolina after I was in South Carolina for a little while. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, okay, I don't want to live at home with my parents anymore. So I was like, okay, here's what I'm going to do. And I was like, we're going to go to Atlanta because everyone said like everything was moving to Atlanta, which it kind of was.
Yeah.
That makes sense. But
there's
like,
production stuff there, but it's
just hard to break into is the problem. It's like huge, like little more massive features than you're like just going to get an entry situation on.
Because I think Walking Dead produces down there. That's like one of the bigger shows that does it. Most everything else is movies.
Yeah. I think one person I worked on those movies with actually works on Ozark in Atlanta right now, and that's like the
They shoot Ozark in Atlanta?
Parts of it. Yeah, right, which makes so much sense. But no. But otherwise, I think everyone else just, like, lives in L.A. Like, I think it's just, like, because that was where everyone came from. It was, like, I was the only, like, one of the few people that was, like, anywhere else. So.
Well, I keep getting told if you want to actually do, like, day-to-day production stuff, you've pretty much got to be in L.A. Because there's, and it's L.A. or New York, and even New York is not the same kind of work. Like, there's some stuff.
Yeah.
There was Girls, although that's over now. There is still Broad City. There's, I think Kimmy Schmidt may produce up there too, but it's there's not much.
Yeah, I don't know. It's like everyone I've ever met is always like, so you think about going to LA? And I'm like, geez, really? Like,
do I have to? Have you tried getting anything around here, or are you? Is that what you're looking into now?
I haven't looked into like actually Chicago. Like I was told like to move here like years before I even thought about it for like from like my comedy writing teacher. She was like, it's like somewhere between New York and like Atlanta as far as like being like a huge city that's gonna punch you in the face. Like, and I was like, cool. She's like, so maybe try Chicago first. And I was like, I don't know, I just don't really, I haven't thought about Chicago.
It's your starter punch in the face.
I was like, Atlanta already sort of like slapped me.
It was light slapping.
Chicago,
you move on to the drubbing.
Yeah,
and then after the drubbing, then you can go for the straight up punch.
Yeah, you go to the punch in New York. New York is just a curb stomp. Like, they just want you dead.
You better, you take some time off, you go to Austin and you get the nice caress.
Yeah, that's nice. Aw.
The shoulder pat.
Good on you.
You tried really hard,
didn't you? So, in kind of wrapping up for this one, what if people want to try and track you down and see what you're doing on other projects down the road, maybe what classes you're taking that they can come see shows for, where can they find you on social media?
I am mostly on Instagram, but I don't know, you can do Facebook messages fine. I just don't get on Facebook and like look at the news feed a lot, but I don't know.
What's your thing on Instagram?
My Instagram is Smurfy Brown.
Oh yeah. Wait, all right, not ending yet, because I want to know, Murphy Brown, like you are a huge Murphy Brown fan, correct?
What are you talking about? I've never seen it. I'm just kidding.
Hey, what are you thinking of the new Murphy Brown? Have you been
watching it? I'm pretty sure they're already canceled, which makes a lot of sense. But no, I think I have a lot of mixed emotions because there's a lot of good things that happen. And like I watched an episode yesterday and like I teared up a little bit. Like it had like some sort of emotional impact, but it's like not written in the same way. And some of like the delivery is slower, and it's just, there's like things are just like a little bit off that like, because they do it all towards the Trump administration, which they literally mention him by name and they mention people by name. And I feel like it could have maybe benefited from like
a little bit of
playing separation. Playing that a little more subtle, I guess. Like,
yeah.
But because it's like kind of a low hanging fruit thing as far as comedy goes to like go after Trump and all that stuff. So I don't know. But like I do. There are parts of it that are like you can see where the joke was going and you're like, that's funny. Mm-hmm. But like, I don't know. Like it's not bad, but I'm also, it's not the same as it previously was.
Well, they also are missing two of the primary actors.
Oh yeah, like a lot of people died from that show. I think so.
Well,
from that show, they watched it and they were like, oh gosh.
The painter in her house.
He
passed away, and he didn't pass away, but the other reporter guy.
Yeah, he's on there in like a couple episodes, but tell he's just like, I'm tired. Please don't make me do this. Sort of like he's very much an older actor, and he's like, I don't.
Yeah, I don't want to have to be here.
Yeah, but he is like part of the crew, so he's like, you know, I'm like, I'm, I don't know,
he pops
I'll
in
hang
from
out.
Time
yeah.
to time. Yeah, but not as like, he was always a fun voice to have it, like this, old school TV news anchor in it. But well, cool. Well, thank you so much for coming on. I appreciate both. I appreciate Graham.
Yeah, I was gonna say we didn't even talk to Graham, and that's what I was looking forward to this whole time. I was like, why am I talking?
Well, it's because Graham was on the show before.
You know, we've talked about this, but I still feel like we should have talked to Graham. And it's just,
I got nothing left.
Oh my god,
Graham! If people want to find you on social media, where can they find you?
Instagram at Graham Bam Jam Band.
You have to think about it every time.
Yes, I know. it's a mouthful.
Well, thank you all for doing this. I appreciate it.
Oh, yeah, no problem.
Thank you,
Tony. Thank you.
That was Murphy Dillow. Thank you to Murphy and to Swoosh and the Harold Ramis Film School and the Second City staff for their help. One quick correction. The comic I named on the show as Jimmy Dore is actually Jeremy Hotz. And there's a link in the credits for this episode if you want to hear some of his stand-up. The song on this week's episode was Easier Said Than Done by The Silent Critics. Find their music on iTunes now. This show is recorded and edited by me, Tony Lazzeroni. If you want to hear more from me and my classmates, teachers, and a few special guests, make sure to subscribe to the podcast. If you have questions or comments, send us an email at filmstudentpod@gmail.com or find us on Twitter and Instagram at filmstudentpod. And be sure to check out some of my and my classmates' work at filmstudentpod.com, where you can also find links to all of our past episodes. See you all next week. Class dismissed.